Hey folks, in this video, yep, we're talking about covalent compounds and Lewis dot structures. And if you understand that subtitle, then let me know. So, objectives. I would like you to be able to explain what a covalent compound is and name common properties of covalent compounds. I would like you to be able to explain how covalent compounds differ from ionic compounds. I would like you to be able to name binary ionic compounds and write formulas for binary ionic compounds. And we got some new vocab like covalent bond, which we talked about, molecule we talked about. Those are not new. So we have covalent compounds. As we know, covalent compounds are composed of two or more nonmetals. And actually, in some instances, just one, like hydrogen, which is two hydrogen atoms covalently bonded together. I just said, but I guess it's two or more nonmetal atoms, I should say. And so here's a real simple guy, and this dude's pretty complicated. So both of those are molecular formulas, and those list the elements that are found in the compound and the ratio in which they occur. So, we know these atoms are held together by things called covalent bonds, and hopefully we recall that covalent bonds are when atoms share their electrons, creating bonds. These bonds are formed when electron orbitals, which we discussed in a previous video, overlap. So, here's an image of two S orbitals. If you recall looking at those S orbitals, they look like spheres. When these dudes come together, they overlap, and that gives us a hydrogen molecule. These two H's overlap and share their electrons through these orbitals, giving us an H2. Similarly, when hydrogen bonds with fluorine, it's a S orbital, and if you recall those cool-looking P subshells, or P orbitals, they look like this, part of the P subshell. And so when hydrogen and fluorine bond, the S orbital of hydrogen overlaps with this P orbital of fluorine, and it makes this weird blah, which is the electrons being shared and the bond between these elements being formed. Neat. So let's talk more about covalent bonds. Each covalent bond is made of two electrons. So when two atoms bond together, they are sharing two electrons. A single bond between two elements is made of two electrons. But if you want to make a double bond as exists in nature, that's going to be made of, four electrons. And pause the video. How many electrons do you think are going to be in a triple bond? Well, that's right. It's going to be six electrons. Every time you make another bond, it's going to be two more electrons. So Lewis dot symbols, we mentioned those at the beginning of the video, those show us how many valence electrons there are on an atom. And we use little dots around our element symbol to show electrons. Each dot represents a valence electron because those are the electrons we really care about. Those are the electrons that do chemistry. So we keep our valence electrons paired up usually, and that represents how electrons are paired up in those orbitals. Remember those orbitals? We talked about them in the past. So shells, those big shells like from our Bohr model, are made up of subshells, and those subshells are made up of orbitals. And each orbital holds two electrons. So here we see an image, and this shows us how to make Lewis structures for our different elements. And if you look down these groups, you can see that everybody in this group has the same Lewis structure. That's because they all have the same outer valence electrons, and thus, the same Lewis dot structure, because Lewis dot structures show us valence electrons. So these dudes all have three valence electrons, these dudes all have five valence electrons, and our noble gases, excluding helium, all have eight valence electrons. If you recall, they have a nice octet, and that makes them very cool and stable. So if we have an ionic compound, we're going to put brackets around it, or rather an ionic Lewis dot structure, or symbol. We'll put brackets around it and put our charge as a superscript on the outside of those brackets. We'll see an example of that in a minute. And so Lewis dot structures are really helpful for helping us show ion formation and for understanding that octet rule. Like we can see that sodium and chlorine hook up to form a sodium ion and a chloride ion. And here our dot on that chlorine, or sodium, represents its one valence electron, while those seven X's on the chlorine represent its seven valence electrons. Well, that sodium gives one electron away to chlorine. Now sodium has emptied its valence electron shell, and it will have all full shells beneath that. Meanwhile, chlorine has filled up its valence electrons shell and now has eight valence electrons. So they're both happy campers. We can see the same thing with magnesium and oxygen combining to form magnesium oxide. Here, magnesium gives away two electrons, emptying its outer shell, to oxygen, which had only six valence electrons. So now magnesium has emptied its outer shell and has all full shells beneath, and oxygen has eight valence electrons, and they're both happy campers. And as I mentioned, when we have ions, we're going to put brackets around our ions and put the charge outside as a superscript. Neat. So if we want to describe covalent bonding with Lewis dot symbols, we're going to draw our Lewis dot symbols for the elements. we're going to put the element with the fewest electrons in the center, excluding hydrogen. Hydrogen doesn't get to go in the middle of any molecules. And we're going to use the lone electrons to form pairs between our atoms, connecting everybody up to our central atom. And remember, each pair of electrons is a bond. So here I've got carbon, who's only got four lone little dots, and I've got my chlorines, each one with one lone little dot. Well, what I can do is pair a chlorine dot with one dot from my carbon, making up four pairs or four bonds. This is one way to show this structure, but I think a much cleaner way to show it is this way, where each bond is represented by a line. So carbon is participating in four bonds. Each bond gives it two electrons, so it has a total of eight electrons around it and is a happy camper. Neat. So let's look at maybe one more example. Here we've got nitrogen, and if we wanted to show multiple bonds, this isn't a great example. These two nitrogen atoms each want to get three more electrons, so they can share their three lone electrons to make three, one, two, three bonds. And as a result, each nitrogen has two of its own electrons, and there are triple bonds between them. Remember, a triple bond is made up of six electrons. So each of these nitrogens is sharing here, and each of them contributes these six to their total. So there's six plus two electrons. Each nitrogen is happy with eight electrons. Here's a cat in a tub. I don't know. It's a great picture. Moving on. Properties of covalent compounds would include that they share electrons to form bonds. That's what we've been talking about. Ionic compounds do not share electrons. Remember, they are held together by their opposite attractions. Unlike ionic compounds, covalent compounds typically have low melting points and boiling points. Ionic compounds, if you recall, have very high melting points, and boiling an ionic compound is almost unheard of. And so this is highly variable. Some covalent compounds have ridiculously high melting points, but they are generally lower than those ionic dudes. For example, nitrogen, which we commonly see as liquid nitrogen, has a boiling point of this. Well, this should be H2O, for water has a boiling point at 100 degrees Celsius. So a big difference between those two, liquid hydrogen has a boiling point that's even lower than nitrogen, for the record. This should be water. I don't care. Let's move on. So covalent compounds in general are not very good at conducting electricity. Ionic compounds are pretty darn great conductors because they have charge, and that charge can move around and help carry electricity. And covalent compounds are far less likely to dissolve in water, even though water is a covalent compound. And we're mostly covalent compounds. Unfortunately, our bodies do not dissolve in water. Many covalent compounds will dissolve in water, but they are less likely to dissolve than our ionic counterparts. And covalent compounds are generally much more flammable than ionic compounds. If you're able to light an ionic compound on fire, that's scary. But most covalent compounds will burn much more easily. So if I want to name binary ionic, so let's talk about naming these binary covalent compounds. Whoops. So if we're going to name them, we need to know which of our two elements is going to go first. The nonmetal with the fewest valence electrons will go first in our formulas. And so, as always when we're naming things, there's a suffix and a prefix going on. Our suffix is only going to go on our second element, and it's just going to be I. Pretty easy peasy, very similar to our binary ionic compounds. So if you see binary stuff, you're probably going to put an I suffix at the end. Prefixes, we've got those. These are going to be based around Greek prefixes, and that's the easiest way to distinguish if you're naming binary covalent or binary ionic compounds. If you hear a Greek prefix, that means you've got covalent stuff. And so Greek prefixes would be like mono, di, tri. I'll put a whole list up on screen in a moment. But the second element is always, always, always going to get a prefix put on it. The first element only gets a prefix if there's more than one. So if you have two, three, four as your subscript on your first element, you will use a Greek prefix. If there's no subscript, no prefix. So let's look at some examples here. There's that beautiful table. Mono, di, tri, tetra, penta, hexa, hepta, octa, nona, deca. They keep going after that. These are the ones that we're going to worry about. So, why don't you, based on these rules, pause the video and try naming these guys. Cool. Pause the video and tried it. Well, we'll go through one or two, and then you try again if you goofed up. So this dude is going to be dihydrogen monoxide. We could call it water, but if we're following these rules, it's going to put this di in front of our first thing because there are two. So dihydrogen, the name doesn't change. And then oxygen becomes oxide. And because there is only one, it's going to be monoxide. Now, instead of calling it monoxide, they just condense that into monoxide. This is unique to oxygen. We don't really see that with our other friends. Cool. Let's go through to the next one. P3, that's going to be tetra. No, not tetra. Tri. Triphosphorus. And then we need to change our suffix here. So this is going to be fluoride, and there's a 7, so it will be heptafluoride. Triphosphorus, heptafluoride. Ah, but shoot, we got to do carbon dioxide first. I goobered up. Either way, carbon dioxide, 2 in front of our oxide. And carbon, there's no prefix there. No subscript. And we are therefore not going to give it a prefix. Since there's only one carbon, we don't call it monocarbon. It's just carbon. Cool. Well, looking at our next example, I already went through this one, but it's triphosphorus heptafluoride. And then looking at this one, well, there's one silicon, so we're not going to put a prefix on it. And then fluoride will become tetrafluoride because there are 4 of those. So silicon tetrafluoride. Nifty, nifty. Well, if we're going to write formulas for binary ionic compounds, we're going to use those prefixes to determine how much or how many of each element is present. And remember, if there's no prefix on that first element, we're only going to put 1 of them in. So why don't you pause the video and try naming these dudes? Sick. You pause the video. Well, let's go through them together. Nitrogen trichloride. I know that there's just 1 nitrogen and 3 chlorines, so this should be NCl3. If I'm naming dicarbon hexa iodide, I know di tells me there's 2 carbons. Hexa tells me there's 3 iodides, which is an iodine, or I. So this should be C2I6. If I'm naming tetraphosphorus disulfide, this tells me there's 4 phosphoruses. Di tells me there's 2 sulfurs, so P4S2. If I'm naming sulfur heptafluoride, this one's going to be sulfur, just 1 sulfur, because there's no mono, and 7 fluorines. If I've got octacarbon decanitride, octa tells me there's 8 carbons, deca tells me there are 10 nitrogens, so C8N10, wow. And if I've got silicon monocarbide, silicon, since there's no prefix, I know there's 1 of them. Monocarbide tells me there's 1 carbon, so this would be SIC. Cool, SIC. So that's the end of this video. I hope you feel pretty cool about these covalent compounds, some of their properties. I hope you feel cool about using Lewis dot structures to understand the octet rule, ion formation and bonding, and I hope you feel good about naming and writing formulas for covalent compounds. Sweet, ta-ta, have a great rest of your life.